3. test. Give as much you can without feedback. 1, 2, 3.
4. You're in the feedback area. Now bring down 1.
Welcome to the Kennedy School of Government, to the forum. I would like to be proud to use this occasion to welcome Theodoros Vangelos, Foreign Minister of Greece, to the Kennedy School. He's going to be talking to us tonight about Europe and the world. And I would like to say one word about the sponsors of this event. The forum has, as you all know, a reputation for hosting events on current affairs. Last year we had President Stephanopoulos who talked to us about Greece, and we are happy to continue this tradition. The forum event tonight is also sponsored by the Hellenic Resources Institute, which is a network of students and scholars who promote and study Greek affairs here at Harvard. And if you are interested by what they do and in getting in touch with them, there is documentation outside this room about HRIs in the table in the back. To introduce Mr. Pangelos, we've asked Ambassador Monty Stearns to be here with us tonight. As you all know, Ambassador Stearns is a very distinguished friend of Greece in the United States. He was ambassador to Greece from 1981 to 1985. And since the last few years, he has been sharing his wisdom in various think tanks and publications around the United States. His last book is entitled Talking to Strangers, American Diplomacy at Home and Abroad. And he's a very ardent observer specifically of Greek affairs. So I'm very happy to leave the floor now to Ambassador Stearns. Thank you.
Calypso, thank you very much, ladies and gentlemen, Mr. Minister. When you leave the auditorium at the end of the program, you will, I think, see displayed a book called The Greek Paradox, Potential versus Performance, which has just come out, published by MIT Press for the Institute of Politics, which is the essence of an extremely interesting and successful conference here at the Institute of Politics in October of 1995. The Greek paradox itself, the common thread that runs through the book, is that Greece by any standard, and certainly by the standards of Southeastern Europe, is in a position to play a remarkably constructive role in stabilizing the area. The question is why that role has not been more constructive. I think that when you hear Minister Pangelos, you will hear a number of ideas on how the Greek role is going to be strengthened and is being strengthened with his help. In a sense, as many of you know, Theodoros Pangelos is himself a metaphor for the Greek paradox, which is to say, he is the son of a conservative military family who has been all of his life a prominent liberal. His grandfather, as you know, was the military governor of Greece for about a year in the 1920s. In any event, very short period. In any event, the minister himself has been an activist of the left who fought valiantly against the Greek junta, who was elected to parliament in The October 18, 1981 elections that brought PASOK and Andreas Papandreou to power, was a close collaborator with Papandreou. And he's also a paradox in another sense. He describes himself as a European socialist, representing a party, PASOK, which was elected on a platform which seemed to declare Greek independence of Europe. So that the minister has worked as a reformer, I think it's fair to say, within PASOK. A last example of the Greek paradox in Minister Spangalos is that if he had not gone into politics and the university, I think he might have been a musician. We introduced him earlier today to Dr. Nicholas Zervas, the distinguished neurosurgeon at Mass General. And the minister said, well, I'm much more interested in your musical activities. Finally, in introducing the minister to you, I note in passing that he is that rarity, a foreign minister with a sense of humor. Diplomacy takes itself very, very seriously, and a foreign minister with a sense of humor can be a dangerous and explosive force. Minister Pangalos, will you join us?
Well, thank you very much, both of you. First of all, I want to thank Mrs. Nikolaidis, although she played a trick against my morale this evening. She told me just now, I didn't know it. I knew her, of course, but I didn't know she was the daughter of a very good friend of mine. It's always a bad time. I think all the older people in this theater have enjoyed the moment when a very distinguished grown-up person tells you he's the son or the daughter of a friend, a contemporary of yours. This makes you feel the weight of age. And as far as the remarks of Moti Stearns, I will certainly not use my meeting with Madeleine Albright tomorrow to discover if she has a sense of humor. This is something I will abstain from doing. But as you approach me through the angle of paradox, I would say that American ambassadors in Greece certainly represented the contradictions of Greek-American relations and the picture the United States had, the image the United States had in Athens. It was always a very important personality of the Greek political world, the United States ambassador. A guy called Purifoy gained a place in Greek history by meeting the king without a tie and putting his feet on the table when he was discussing with Greek political leaders. He was the bad American. And I would say diplomatically that the good American image is shared by many of his successor, but certainly I think the Greek public will say the most outstanding good American we have had in Athens was Montigle Stearns, and we shall never forget him. So this didn't mean, of course, that he didn't serve well American interests, that he always agreed with us. This is not the case. Speaking about Europe and in an American university, in this distinguished school of political thought, first has to see, I think, Europe in a relative way. It needs an effort for a European to see Europe in the world. We usually suffer from the mental sickness that is described as Eurocentrism. We think that Europe is the center of the world, and it's very difficult to understand that sometimes is not so. Today, Europe is certainly a very important part of the contemporary reality. Europe is the biggest market in the world in buying power. It is the second biggest investor abroad after the United States. It has some advantages and some disadvantages. Our productivity is lower than that of the United States or Japan, but our trade with the rest of the world represents a better equilibrium than that of the United States, certainly lags behind Japan. And we have almost no external debt, and like the United States, which is, as you know, is in a very difficult situation as far as it concerns this aspect of things. Europe has another interesting future. The majority of inventions and creations in the world occur still in European institutes and universities, although they are almost, as a rule, in the great majority, these new ideas, new discoveries are exported and are used either through multinational firms or through brain drain, which has brought, I think, some of you also to the United States, are exported and used either by the American or the Japanese economy. So this is the set of relations that characterizes the three big centers of economic, cultural, and scientific activity in the world. The American reaction to European unification in the beginning was, I would say, indifference. The Americans thought this was just another international organization and treated Europe in that way. Then it was a very reserved approach when Europe started to be interesting, especially after the first enlargement to the United Kingdom. The American leadership started having anxieties about Europe, questions, putting questions, and was very reserved indeed. In some cases, it tried to stop the evolution of Europe to further integration. I think there is a third period, which I will situate in the beginning of the Clinton era, where the administration studied thoroughly the European phenomenon and took a much more positive stand against what was happening in Europe. I have followed many contacts between the European Union and the American leadership. In the beginning, the idea of a contact at the highest level between an entity that was called Europe was almost impossible to understand for the American legislators and administrators. I remember that when we tried in the first Greek presidency to organize a meeting between members of the Congress and the European Parliament, the answer from the Congress was that this was a to say, an almost insane idea, because the Congress was representing a nation and the European Parliament could not pretend to represent anything at all, because a parliament of many nations was something that was unthinkable from the point of view of political theory and tradition. And there was no European nation then, and so there could be no European Parliament. Finally, the meeting took place. The American, the members of Congress, the distinguished members of Congress, were clearly in Athens for tourist purposes. They were not coming to the meetings, and when they were coming to the meetings, they were making fun of the European parliamentarians, putting all sort of intimidating and scornful questions. So you see that since that time, speak about 81, In a very short period, in 15 years, a lot of distance has been covered. When, during the third Greek presidency, we met with the then Prime Minister Andreas Papandreou with President Clinton in Brussels. He was then a young president, not very well known to the European public. I must say we were astonished by the grasp and the knowledge of the European problems he demonstrated and his capacity to negotiate even very complicated technical issues like, let's say, agricultural policy issues, almost without consulting his notes and without the assistance of the people who were with him. It was clear that the American administration has gone a long way, took Europe seriously into consideration, and was ready to have an American policy towards Europe that was a constructive policy of cooperation and understanding. Of course, Europe was not the same through the decades. When this adventure started, there was a political aim and a very limited practical scope. The political aim was to bring together, in a close cooperation, Germany and France, so that it would not be possible to have again in Europe a French-German conflict. This was undertaken mainly through a cooperation in steel and coal. It was a very traditional approach. As you know, the two world wars, in a great extent, happened because France had the iron and Germany had the coal. And these fundamental resources for modern industry were in adjacent areas, and the control of these areas was given industrial advantage over the neighbor. So the Germans tried to snatch away Lorraine, and the French tried to snatch away the rule from the Germans. Putting together the resources of coal and iron was creating a new situation in Europe. The common management very quickly led to new enterprises. And this all lasted as long as Europe was reconstructing. That's up to the middle 60s, where the demand for iron products collapsed. New countries entered the iron market. And the problem for Europe was to get rid of its iron production, not to create better management of the sector. But in the meanwhile, ambitious technocrats, the people we call in Franglais, in French English language, Eurocrats, try to, by the way, krats is from the Greek word krato, which means dominate, handle. So these Eurocrats created a further cooperation which included a common market and an agricultural policy. Germany was in for the common market. They had acquired very fastly a relative advantage in productivity and the quality and the cost of industrial products. They wanted a larger market for their expanding industrial production. And the French were in for agriculture because they wanted to expand into exporting mainly what we call in European language northern products, that's cereals, meat, milk. Actually, this cooperation worked well for a long period with adjustments, small crisis, but it worked well. The other countries were in for the small size of this construction, especially about the Benelux countries, which were small countries. And Italy, of course, participated in a double way, because Italy was a very clearly divided economy and society. The northern industry was very German in its attitude, an aggressive exporting industry, and the rural south was in for the agricultural policy, and in some extent for the funds that very soon the Italians managed to absorb from the European Union, in some cases misusing them in a very characteristic way. If you go, for instance, from Brindisi to Lecce in southern Italy, in the area we call in Greece Magna Grecia, in some kind of megalomania, you will notice that there are two absolutely magnificent highways with very little traffic that are parallel to each other, separated by about 30 kilometers. Sometimes you can see the other motorway with nobody on it for years now. It is a typical example of misuse of community funds. This was the beginning of the structural policy of the community, and it was a very bad one indeed. Then there was the first enlargement, and the first enlargement created an altogether new situation. The United Kingdom came in, and its clients, Denmark and Ireland, were very closely associated countries with the British economy. They had stayed out of the European unification because the United Kingdom did not want to abandon its Atlantic relations and its Commonwealth for the narrow perspectives of Europe at that time. And Denmark and Ireland, very dependent on the British market, went along. I remember that General de Gaulle said then to the British, they will have to choose between the Atlantic and Europe, and he said it in his wonderful French with a phrase that I remember, il faut choisir entre l'Europe et le grand large. He then said that when finally the British came in, he said, well, we have the British, and they brought along their breakfast, because Ireland was producing the eggs and Denmark the bacon, which are substantial elements of an Anglo-Saxon breakfast, as we know. So a new era started, and since then, a fundamental difference in attitudes is characterizing the European construction, its achievements, and its contradictions. Britain is in for the market, and they want the market to be as open as possible to the outside world. And this action of the British has created great moments of crisis and self-determination for Europe. I think some of you might remember or might have read about the big Thatcher crisis of the budgetary refunds. The idea was very simple and was very popular in the United Kingdom, but a whole world was hiding behind this negotiation, this crisis, this confrontation. Mrs. Thatcher's government came to Europe and proposed what was equivalent to a sin at this time. They proposed to the rest of the partners to sin together. The scene was the idea of just return. Britain said, I contribute too much in Europe's budget. I want to have a negotiation so as to have some of this money refunded back to me, my economy. This was absolutely unacceptable. And, it looks, of course, an act of elementary justice, but it was totally unacceptable because the clear outcome of a country's transactions with Europe is not only the result of how much money the country is giving to Europe, is taken from Europe, but also the result of how much money the country is paying to Europe. And this is mainly for objective reasons. The countries contribute, these are the community's own resources, if they don't play the game of the internal market. So if you import from abroad, if you buy, for instance, as the British do, cheap meat from Australia or New Zealand, you have to pay the difference of the price from the community prices to the community budget. So in some extent, your account with the Union depends on how good a European you are. And if you have this money refunded to you, that means that there is an incitation not to behave by the rules. Actually, Greece has a positive balance with the Union. This is the result, of course, of substantial help the Greek economy is receiving through the structural funds, but in the same time, it's the result of the fact that Greece is a determined European country, does not trade with the external world, only in very limited proportions, is a very good client of the European market that Greece plays by the rules. So it's not, it doesn't have to contribute in the extent the British economy does to the European Union's own resources. So if you take, for instance, the positive amounts thrown in by the Union to each individual country, you will notice with some surprise, maybe, that the biggest beneficiary, if you take only the positive amounts, not the negative amounts, if you take what the Union gives to a country, not what the country gives to the Union, the more positive performance is that of Denmark, and the second one is that of Ireland. So you see, it's not the poorest countries that get money from the Union in a positive way, it is the result, which is something different. So this crisis lasted for years, and at the outcome of this crisis, a new step was taken forward in the market, in the achievement of a unified market. That was after the total elimination of all customs, of all custom fees, the elimination of all the technical barriers. The European countries were producing even some elementary goods according to different procedures, had different regulations. I remember that when we started the exercise for the elimination of the technical barriers, the plugs you use to put the commodity in contact with your electrical system, in Europe were 37 different types. Now there are only 6, which means that anything produced in any country can be sold and circulate in any other country without adaptation. So you see that the fluidity of the market has greatly increased, both because nobody pays anything to the customs, which, by the way, have in the internal trade of the community been abolished, and also because the products that are produced are in great extent submitted to identical procedures of certification. So we have the big market, and the big market gave a new impetus to the European economy. The overall experience was positive. Growth and employment have been maintained very high, although other elements of the economic situation were critical. For instance, the competition from the new countries was playing an ever-increasing role. Where I think Europe has been an enormous success is, of course, that of the agricultural policy. If the things were left to the laws of the international market, Europe would most probably not have any agricultural production by now. As you know, Europe is a major productor in all foodstuffs and agricultural raw materials, and this is given to the European Union not only a great advantage as far as it concerns the terms of trade, but also it's an important contribution to the strategic ability of the Union, especially its ability to influence the evolution in the third world and the countries which have problems of self-sufficiency in agricultural products, and also it's a great contribution to the European environment. Through this period, adaptations of the institutional system also were necessary. We have gone through two major intergovernmental conferences, and the idea that we are heading towards a supranational entity that will be created from the national states, but will coexist with the national states and have a similar kind of political authority, was which was not something one could think about, let's say, in the middle of the 60s or even in the beginning of the 70s. This idea appeared, is on the table, the idea of a federal political entity that will not be, of course, some kind of United States of Europe, like the United States of America function, but will be a dynamic process leading to that. This idea has appeared, and today it is, let's say, in the core of the discussions we are having inside the intergovernmental conference, which is on the way. This was also the secret, let's say, the answer to the American misunderstanding. The answer to the question, what is Europe? Is it an international organization? Or is it a commercial agreement? And because it's not clearly, it's not a national state. I think the answer is that the European Union is not an object. It is a process. It's an evolution towards a federal political entity. What this federal political entity will be will have to be answered during the years. We might have also setbacks. Some countries may drop out. Some countries may be introduced who will cover the distance that is separating them from the main dynamic. Thus appeared the question of Europe's geometry, or the question of variable speeds towards European integration. What we are now discussing are fundamentally three critical questions. The first one is, how large can Europe be without losing elementary cohesion? This is a geographical question. It's also a question regarding the economic and social aspects that define the new societies which are asking for a place in the European family. It was a question that already had to be answered during the last enlargement. It was asked in a it was answered in a positive way, and I think the answer was correct, because the Scandinavian countries and Austria contribute a lot in the European integration, have been assimilated. They influenced in a positive way, at least for a European socialist, as Monty Gustel said before, by increasing the sensibility of Europe to social problems, unemployment, the role of the weaker groups of the population, the rights of this or the other category of citizens, like women, children, the immigrants, in all these aspects which were overlooked a little bit in the past, the new members have contributed to create further sensitivities, further possibilities of action. Also, the fact that three of the new members were neutral countries, and remained so, did not hinder the European Union from increasing its political cooperation and the research, further research for a common foreign policy, and also the construction of a defense organization, which is the Western European Union, in relation and in the framework of course, of the Western defense as it is expressed by NATO. The answer we have to give now has to take number of given situations in consideration. First of all, countries that do not and cannot see in the foreseeable future a possibility to be integrated in the economic process cannot be members of the European Union. Countries that don't have, let's say, an per head income that is at least 40 or 50% of the European average will have a great difficulty in sustaining the rhythm. Greece, as you know, is at this situation, and the experience of Greece, I think, is a lesson for anyone else. Europe is not a paradise. It's not a place where you get free gifts. You have to pay, and you have to pay hard in efforts, structural adjustment, and introducing progress both in production and in the organization of society. Otherwise, you can't keep up. The second limitation is that I think that new members have to have a minimal relationship with the cultural and political environment of Europe. Structures, institutions, social and political practices, the relation to the press and the freedom of the press, the relation of political parties and the way they replace each other in the roles of the majority and the minority in the relevant representative bodies are very important. It is not possible in a Europe that becomes more and more democratic who are elected representatives of the people, the European Parliament, will play a further increased role to have partners who have not been able to guarantee the normal functioning of representative institutions at home. The third aspect is, I think, also the necessity for a clear choice for the European unification, for the European common identity. There are, and the possibility to do so. We tend to forget that in the world we live in, I think this is in a particular way real here, Russia still exists. The disappearance of the Soviet Union as a leader of a military alliance that was threatening our institutions and way of life seems to me to have created a relief that makes oblivion a common attitude of responsible people. But Russia exists. Russia is an enormous country. It is certainly going to be one of the actors of the future. Russia has an immense potential for economic development, enormous population, and even more enormous territory, resources, and specifically human resources, a very highly qualified population, would need simply to be put in work and adapt to the new structure. Russia will come not only as a challenger, and I hope as little as possible as a challenger, but will come also as a possibility in some cases. It is very characteristic that in Greece a new trend of ideas appears, which seem to have disappeared from the public dialogue. Greeks are inclined to like Russians. They are, all of them, Orthodox. They don't think that a priest who has a long beard is a strange phenomenon, like sometimes some people in the Catholic or the Protestant West do. And Russia has always been a great hope for the Greek populations during the Ottoman rule. The problem in contemporary Greek politics was that the people that are more inclined to think in religious, traditional, and nationalistic terms, that is the center-right, were obliged to hate the Russians because they were communists. Now, they don't have this obligation anymore, and it's very characteristic that all these pan-Orthodox and ideas start to come from the natural ideological and cultural space that is the center-right. That's a warning also. I think that the West has to behave towards Greece in a decent way, because you will have in Greece something that Ambassador Purifoy could never predict, a right-wing government which will support Russia against the United States, for instance. It might sound like a joke, but it represents a part of the contemporary reality. So, coming back to my analysis of the European reality, some countries might not want to be too far from Russia, and some other countries might not be allowed to be too far from Russia. I can think about the Baltic countries, Ukraine, Romania, eventually the countries of the Caucasus, which are very much interested in getting more associated to the European integration, because they think, and they have the right, I think, to do so, that they belong to the European sphere of influence. We are in the beginning of great transformations, and what I have described as the new era of American-European relations, I think, will play a fundamental role into forming the geography of tomorrow's world. I'm sure that for somebody who lives and works in universities in the United States, there are other subjects of study and interest. After all, Southeast Asia is a fascinating world. China is there. And I read very recently Henry Kissinger, who wrote that when in 20 or so years, China, if the Chinese economy keeps up with the rhythm of growth it actually has, then in 20 to 25 years, China will have the per head income of today's Greece or Portugal, then the overall global national income of China will be 3 times that of the United States. So this is something to reckon about. And of course, these are fascinating also subjects of study. But I think also one should get used to the idea that an equal partner will appear in Europe. And when I speak about equality, I don't speak in terms, of course, of rights, because in the legal sense of the word, we are all equals. Equal in the sense that Europe will have an equal participation in the world economy, that maybe the common currency that we are creating together will be a currency that will compete with the dollar in international markets, and also that Europe's scientific invention, creativity, and military capacity will be at equivalent levels with that of the United States. And the idea is how to get better acquainted and how to find a smooth way of cooperation in that Atlantic Union, which has to be not a defensive project, as NATO was from its creation, not a cooperation to protect us from threat, but a positive alliance to give major opportunities both to the United States and the European Union, which is an international entity emerging from today's realities. Maybe I spoke too much.
Thank you very much, Mr. Pangalos. You've given us a very sweeping history of Europe and in a historical sense, it makes us think back about this very long path and how far we have come in European integration. I would like to encourage the participants in this conference to come to the microphones and introduce themselves and ask questions. I will use the prerogative of the chair while people are moving forward to ask the first question. You need to move to the microphones when you want to ask questions. And since you ended your talk on Europe-United States relations, We remember last year when Holbrooke stated that his European colleagues were asleep while the Aegean Sea crisis loomed for Greece. This was not the first and only time when we have seen Greece relying at least as much on the United States as it's on its European partners in times of crisis, be it Cyprus or situations in the Balkans. And this leads us to ask whether Greece, to what extent Greece wants to strengthen a common foreign European policy. You could say that it might lead Greece to want to create institutions whereby European actors are solidaire around Greece in crisis, but at the same time one might argue that this would make it harder for Greece to be able to play between the Europeans and the United States, play not in a negative sense, but use both whenever necessary. In this conundrum, in this dilemma, what is the right path for Greece? How will it continue to balance its relations between its European partners and its American partners? And what does this imply for what we are looking for in the revisions of the common foreign policy?
This is the first question.
If you can give a very short answer, yeah. Because I see that we have a lot of...
Well, you know, I don't know if Dick Holbrooke, whom I discovered that night, I have never met him before, and I think we became closely associated afterwards. I met him several times since. The last time was for lunch last week in Athens, where he was for an award that was given to his wife, who is a distinguished activist for press freedom and the rights of the people of the press in countries where they are not recognized. I don't think if he was right to say that they were asleep. It was not a polite thing to say, but it was true. And what he didn't say, of course, it was that he did not make any sacrifice himself, because during that night in America it was day. So he actually was not asleep because she was not supposed to be asleep. But the reality is that for the Greek-Turkish crisis, this particular moment, which was in the, how to say, some hours from military activities, from military confrontation, Europe could do very little, because Europe had no leverage. I'm saying now that even if we suppose that Europe had a Minister of Foreign Affairs, because that was what Holbrooke was, he was acting as a Minister of Foreign Affairs. Even if Europe had a Minister of Foreign Affairs, which it doesn't have, and which we want to it to have, Europe would not have the leverage, for the simple reason that this was a military confrontation, and the United States are arming Turkey, not Europe, or if Europe does, it does it in a very secondary way. So Europe, Greeks and Turks were going to fight mostly, with some exception, with United States armaments. And this, of course, creates a leverage. To give you just a technical reason, if you fight for a week, then you need spare parts, things like that. And if you know that the country that has given you this kind of instruments is not going to provide you with the maintenance, then fighting has no reason to be. So the Americans had the leverage. They use it in a positive way. We avoided confrontation. Europe could not, even if my partners in the European Union were not sleeping, which was not the case for all of them, some of them were not sleeping and called me during that night. But anyhow, even if they all were not sleeping, what could they do? We cannot decide if we don't meet together. We don't have a Mr. Europe. We don't have a Mr. Foreign Policy. We don't have an administration that could take decisions and take practical initiatives. So in if Dick Holbrooke wanted to demonstrate this inability, it was not very polite to do that, but it's true. Now, I want to say also that Europe has an history of, let's say, 30 years. The United States are not a very old nation, but the Americans are not a very old nation, but the United States has been created, as you know, in the 18th century. And furthermore, that Europe is the unique experience of nation building through consensus without violence. As you know, the United States, even the United States, were created after two major political victories were assured. One is the elimination of the resistance of the native population, the Indians. And the second was the war between the North and the South. And if you look in all the nation-building experiences in Europe, you'll always find that they come through the victory, the military victory, and the domination of a part of this actual nation on the others. England invaded Scotland, not to speak about Ireland. The French eliminated Burgundy. In Italy, you know very well the history of the Risorgimento, and Prussia dominated all the little German states. This has been through wars and military domination. In Europe, we try to do that by consensus, and we are not doing badly. So if Dick Holbrooke is foreign minister again, and if we have another crisis, I hope among other people, not between Greeks and Turks, he might find a European foreign minister to speak to over the telephone.
Well, if I may, I would like to ask you a question about the crisis in the relations between Turkey and the Greece. Now, since March, Mr. Minister, 1947, the American foreign policy, rather, when the Truman administration began, you will permit me a few observations, and then I am coming to the question.
I have to fly to Washington at 8:30. If you start at 47, we might not be over the question. We are in 97 now. It's 50 years ago.
The question is that the perception of the strategic position of Turkey is that that country has a very high strategic value. Now, the question is, to what extent does this perception of the American government affect the attitude of the United States government vis-a-vis the crisis between Greece and Turkey?
Yes, thank you very much. I think the question can be answered in a very simple way. Not only the American attitude, but also the attitude of the main European countries is that is based on the recognition of the fact that Greece is right. This has been public also. It's not something that I don't simply transmit my personal impression. You know, there is a position of the State Department, of the President of the United States, of the Council of the Ministers of the European Union, that Greece is right, because Greece is in accordance with international law and international practices, and proposes a very moderate, a very practical way of getting out of the crisis, which is accept a legal frame, the intervention of a third recognized party, that is the Court of the Hague, and then negotiate in what way these solutions can be found. The Turks, on the contrary, say that they want to have a negotiation without legal reference and without providing for the final judgment, that is, who is going to say who is right or wrong. if we disagree. And this is not a way of approaching things, as we understand, that can be accepted by the international community. Now, the problem is why the Turks have been able to get away with it such a long time, and why they can start again and again and present new claims and new demonstrations of behavior that are not ordinarily accepted. If you compare, for instance, what has happened to the Serbs when they invaded Bosnia, or to the Iraqis when they invaded Kuwait, to what has happened to the Turks, who invaded Cyprus and maintained their presence there and tried to dictate rules of behavior for the government of Cyprus, you shall see there is an enormous difference in the treatment. Also, if you take the Cyprus issue again and compare the arrogance and out of any sense of measure demands of the Turkish minority there, and if you compare it to the situation of Russians in Estonia, let's say, or Hungarians in Romania, which are who have rights and ask to have these rights, and they try to defend them, but are minorities and recognize they are minorities. The problem in Cyprus is that 18% of the population claims to share political power in half. They want 50% of the power, which is not a democratic way to rule, to live, of course. And this all, and the question why does Turkey get away with that, I think is answered in your question. The West had always the impression that Turkey is a reliable partner in defending the West against some kind of external threat. The external threat was communism, and then it became Islamism. And now we have Islamic government in Turkey, so the threat of for the future is that these Islamic forces become really Islamic, because now they are supposed not to be really Islamic, which in fact they are not, but the whole argument becomes much more complicated. I think this is the wrong approach. It is the approach of, they say, President Truman, once when he was asked about Trujillo, somebody in his environment said, "Mr. President, this is a real bastard." And he said, President Truman answered, "He's my own bastard. So I have to defend him." I don't think if this kind of approach is a correct one. I don't think this can lead to victories. I think this is a wrong approach. The American foreign policy has made these mistakes in the past, when the United States overthrew Sihanouk in Cambodia to replace him by Lon Nol. Some of you might remember what happened. Or in the case of Iran, when the West was accepting all the demonstrations of paranoia and abuses of human rights that characterized the regime of the Shah. And finally, we found ourselves with the present regime in Iran, which I don't know if it is exactly what we thought we would have. So I think, of course, Turkey has to be considered in a very serious way. It's a very big nation. It's a country that will play an important role in the future. Progressive forces and democratic forces in Turkey should be supported, human rights protected, including the minority rights, and Greece has an enormous interest, including a financial and commercial interest, into promoting a relationship of Turkey with the European Union. But this cannot be done over an attitude which I describe as get out of my way and let me do my business attitude, because this is the attitude of some people in Western capitals. They feel that Greece is in the way, creating problems that might not exist. If Greece was not there, if Greece did not exist in some way, if the Greeks disappeared, both in Cyprus and mainland Greece. This is not the case. The problems are there because Turkey is an unstable and democratic and confused society. As long as the situation there is what it is, the West should take very careful steps to orient Turkey to the good decisions, and certainly accepting their irrational and illegal demands is not the best way to do so.
Mr. Binge, I read in this week's Economist that 14 of the members of the European Union wish to start the discussion of the admission of Cyprus to the Union, but wish to have this discussion with the Cypriot government and the Turkish representative. My question is, does this represent de facto recognition of the legitimate occupation? And if so, what are the steps that you as foreign minister are taking to counteract this initiative?
Well, you know, the idea that 14 countries were for this is not exact, for the simple reason that the European Union discussions do not go that way. What has happened was that the British government, which, as you know, has worked over a long period for the happiness and the progress of the Cypriot people and the freedom of Cyprus, and they seem not to forget. I mean, the British have a problem with Cyprus. They were the Cypriots were the only people in the world who were not born British, to which the British government offered citizenship, and the Cypriots refused. And not only they refused, but they started killing the British to persuade them to get away from the island. This is something I think no Englishman who respects himself will ever forget. Because giving somebody British citizenship is something that is really an honor that should be appreciated. And the Cyprus didn't understand. As you see, I'm very objective on the issue. So the British put forward a paper for the structural dialogue between Cyprus and the European Union. There are two things. The Association Council that took place and was a very positive one, and the structural dialogue, which is an advanced form of political cooperation between candidate countries and the European Union. For the structural dialogue, the British proposed a paper. It was not usual. It had never happened before. And in this paper, they tried to change the engagement of the Union, that it will start negotiations with the Cyprus government 6 months after the end of the intergovernmental conference. They tried to do that by putting in a phrase that could be interpreted, it's not a very clear phrase, it could be interpreted that the Turkish Cypriots will participate in the negotiation. That means that the European Union will negotiate with two partners, not with a single partner. As you understand, this is actually putting in jeopardy the European perspective of Cyprus, because the position of the Turkish Cypriot community is a given. Mr. Denktaş has said that Cyprus should not enter the European Union if Turkey does not enter the European Union, which is, of course, putting this perspective in a very in the foreseeable future. So that's why Greece resisted, and that's why the structural dialogue did not take place, although Greece, as a compromise solution, offered to have the structural dialogue without this paper, which was not necessary. This was Germany supporting Britain on the issue, and 12 other countries not taking part in the discussion. This is the real picture. It's not 14 countries against Greece. During our meeting this Saturday in Holland, I will present the real choice to my partners. That is respect our engagements, or otherwise put into a generalized crisis the whole perspective of enlargement. Greece is sticking by what we have agreed. Cyprus was going to have, together with Malta, but Malta, as you know, walked out, was going to have a first chance to have a negotiation for enlargement. Then Greece accepted, because of our major interest in that area, that other countries than Cyprus could be included in the first package, together with Cyprus, but that's all we can do. We will never accept, never is never in that case, that any negotiation will start for further enlargement of the community without an equal treatment of Cyprus, and we will never accept the British government to put into question decisions of the United Nations that have been taken over the decades. And as I am a European socialist, Monty, if you allow me, I hope we'll have an altogether different government and different position of Cyprus in some weeks.
My name is Sefi Poropapa.
I didn't speak as a foreign minister now.
My name is Poropapa. I'm an Albanian American. And I want to thank you very much for your candid and illuminating lecture. With due modesty, I recommend you personally and the Greek government and the entire Greek leadership in their marvelous comportment vis-a-vis the Albanian crisis. Perhaps in conjunction with this crisis and your elaboration of your talk and the European new beautiful Europe, I'd like to ask the following question. What is the number of the Greek minority in southern Albania?
Well, this is a difficult question to answer, and I think it's not a very interesting question. The Hoxha regime, the communist regime in Albania, was accepting a number of 60,000. Greek organization of people from this area spoke sometimes about 250,000. The reality must be someplace in between, something between 100 and 150,000, I think is a probable situation. But the question is, as you must know, if you are an Albanian.
I'm an Albanian American.
Yes, but you have been living in Albania, I presume, no?
Not much.
Not lately. You know that Greeks and Albanians have been living together for very long periods and are very confused. I mean, there have been a lot of Greeks who have spoken Albanian, and a sort of Albanian, which is called Arvanitica, which is an ancient form of Albanian. These people came from Albania in the 10th century. That's a very long period ago. At this time, British, French, and of course Albanians and Greeks did not exist. It was simply the Eastern Roman Empire, of whose citizens were both Albanians and people who were speaking Albanian, who were speaking this Arvanitic language, and Greek. And major influence of both the Greek language speaking groups and the Arvanitica speaking groups are felt in both countries. So I think that in today's Albania, there is a number of people who feel associated to Greece in some way. They don't feel Greeks, maybe, but they feel associated to Greece because they have a parent who was Greek, who belonged to the minority, or they speak some form of Greek, or simply because after the collapse of the regime, Greece is a country which is very close, it's the natural place to go, and why most, many countries went there. Many of your fellow countrymen went to Greece and are living there. Greece has expelled last year 250,000 illegal immigrants from Albania. some of them for the second or the third time, so it's not the real number. The real number must be something between 80,000. But if we have been able, with a police that is not very efficient, the Greek police is notoriously inefficient, if we manage to expel about 50 or 80,000, that means that several hundred thousand people in Greece, you meet them everywhere. Of course, they're underpaid. They do hard work. But without this indirect contribution, without the acceptance by the Greek people of these people living and working among us, I think the situation in Albania would be terrible. The situation is terrible now, but it is because all these amounts of money that were gained through very hard labor in Greece were used in a very bad way. And I'm unhappy to say that we had a discussion with that, with the authorities in Albania, 1 year and a half before, when we say to them that what they do in the private sector with these investment schemes cannot work, it was going to collapse. And, but there was another, how to say, another confidence in the freedom of market. You know, it was a norm. The freedom, the free market, and the capitalism was unknown, and people. Jumped in this new society and the new opportunities, and it is a disaster now from the economic point of view, and I hope it's not going to be a disaster from the political point of view if everybody shows further moderation.
Mr. Pangalos?
What we propose, if you allow me to tell you, what we propose to the Albanian government, the President, Prime Minister Simitri was talking with President Berisha yesterday, what we propose to them is to have a meeting in Athens between the political forces of the country and the government. We don't want to direct or advise such a meeting. We simply offer the technical possibilities to hold it, and they can choose the partners they want. It can be the European Union or the OEC or nobody. We have had such an experience with the presidents of Croatia, Serbia, and Bosnia, Izetbegovic, Milosevic, and Tuđman, and it worked. At the end of the meeting, we had diplomatic relations between the three countries. They decided among themselves. We simply played the role of technical assistance and secretarial work, and it worked. So if we can bring together the political forces in Albania in some kind of dialogue that will create a government, I wouldn't call it of national unity, but of emergency, an emergency government to tackle this problem, I think this could be a solution.
Minister Pangalos, with due modesty, I have a State Department human rights report in 1994, in which the leaders of the Greek minority in Albania declared that there are between 70 and 80,000 Greeks in Albania. I have it with me if you like to have it.
Yes, but I don't see why you try so hard to persuade us that there are few Greeks in Albania. The problem with Albania is not that it has more Greeks than it should. The problem with Albania is it has less Greeks than it should, and less. And if the situation goes as it is, there will be very few Albanians left because they run away.
Mr. Secretary.
Was I next or the gentleman there?
I am the next.
I got the Mr. Pangalos, my name is Alexander Stathis, and this question comes from my father, Spiro. He's from Northern Epirus. Basically, what I wanted to ask you is the Greek minority in Northern Albania, in Epirus, is experiencing persecution, and the Greek government is still showing an indifference, whereas you have Catholics and you have Turkish, you know, minorities there, but yet they are not experiencing as much persecution as the Greeks.
I don't agree with you. I think we have had an Albanian nationalist, now we are going to hear to a Northern Epirus nationalists.
And there's more than
400,000. I don't think there is a special persecution of the Greeks. I think there is a very bad situation of the Greek community there, as there is a bad situation for the Albanians as a whole. I don't really think there is special persecution. We have agreements. We have promoted development plans. We have been working very freely in Albania in collaboration with Albanian authorities. And we have schools, we have new schools, and we have very few children. And in some cases, it was very difficult to open the schools because we didn't find Greek students, Greek pupils, Greek children. So if you love Northern Epirus and you want to have a real Greek presence there, the advice I have to give you as a young man is migrate to Northern Epirus and stay there.
No, well, the Greek government doesn't show any...
And then
any,
give us lessons. Come on.
Mr. Secretary...
Every patriotic individual from Northern Epirus should be in Northern Epirus and not in Boston. I'm not going to apologize to you. I'm not going to answer this kind of question. I'm here for another occasion, and I have duties to the people who invited me. You are still in this Cold War. You are still in the Cold War. And what you have done is what everybody has done during the Cold War. Maybe you're right to have these feelings, but they don't help at the present moment. They're not in contact with reality. The reality is different from what you imagine.
Mr. Secretary, my name is Anestis Ganotakis. My origin is from the island of Rhodes. I have a great concern with the daily threats of the Turks in the Aegean. And I am wondering, let us suppose that at some point there is a very serious crisis. The Turks appear in an island like they did at Timia. Are the Greek people ready to defend their country? Would any of the countries of the European Union stand by the side of Greece?
Well, I think a military operation against Greece by Turkey is something some people in Ankara have been studying in the last year and preparing for. I don't think Turkey will jump in the world of madness. But if this happens, of course, we will have to follow them, and we will do so. But I think this is a rather remote possibility. We are very hard at work to find solutions to the problems and a way to engage negotiations, provided Turkey accepts a legal frame and a third party which will take the final decision about who is right and who is wrong. And in that framework, I think we can be more optimistic about the future, and you can have less anxieties about Rhodes and the other beautiful islands of the Dodecanesus.
Mr. Brangalos, my name is Elaine Papoulias. I'm a student at the Fletcher School. As Greece has implemented its austerity program in the effort to reach Maastricht targets, its defense spending is at all-time highs. Is it sustainable, and will it be an impediment to reaching convergence in 2001?
Yes, we can sustain our military expenditure together with the convergence plan. Our military expenditure is compatible with our convergence plan. Of course, everything would be easier if military expenses were less important in relation with the GDP and GNP and in relation with the budget, overall budget. And I think that we have to take into consideration that to have a reduction of military expenses, we need to have a framework of international guarantees of what is of what decisions shall be taken about the Cyprus issues and the Greek Turkish relations. Why I say that? Because even if supposedly we don't have any more problems with Turkey, Turkey will not reduce its military expense. And because Turkey has other problems. Turkey has problems with the Arab world, Turkey has problems with Russia, with Iran, and these problems will be increasing in the future. And also because Turkey has a society where the military establishment is taking decisions, controls the economy. 30% of the industrial production of Turkey is the result of activities of business that belong to the army. The private car co-produced with Fiat in Turkey, Mr. Filon knows the name, he has head on. Renault Oyak is an army enterprise. It's the most popular car in Turkey. And the officers, the military establishment, want military expenses because this is keeping up their place in society. So even if we have a solution and we have a reduction of Greek military expenses, it will not be followed by a corresponding reduction of Turkish military expenses. And as Turkey, as I told you, is a stable country, where uncertainty about the future is something that I think one can easily understand, I think that we need an international guarantee. That's why we are inclined to treat the Cyprus problem and the Greek-Turkish relations as international problems, problems for the international community. So it answers also to your question.
Mr. Secretary.
Sorry, I've just been told that
there is no more time.
The minister is going to miss his plane if we don't stop. And here.
If I miss my plane, I will miss Madeleine Albright tomorrow morning at 8.
How unfortunate.
Which is the reason, among others, I came to the United States.
Could you at least give us one?
Let's have the last question.
One more, please.
Let's have the two last questions. I will answer very shortly.
I think it was my turn. Excuse me. Thank you. You have presented us several situations concerning the European Union and Greece at the present with considerable knowledge and humor. But I think that anybody who has a basic knowledge of the situation can discern behind your interesting comments that Greek external policy is characterized by a series of dead ends. You have more or less talked about Greek low productivity and inherent inability to catch up with European integration, problems in the relations with Turkey in which our European counterparts do not have the ability to intervene, do not even seem interested in intervening, and a situation, a very dangerous situation with Turkey in which we are treated as equals with a country that's obviously threatening us militarily almost every semester. What I wanted to ask you is, how are you planning as a scholar and as a socialist visionary to face all these problems? You have presented us with very ambitious and courageous and encouraging predictions about the future. You have talked about mediations, regimes, peace, but given the fact that we know Turkey has been violating treaties international agreements at a tremendous rate as compared to other countries. Do you really think that all these proposals you've presented us are realistic and are going to give a solution to Greece's problems in its external policy?
Well, I think the proposals are realistic. That's why maybe they don't seem as visionary as they could be. I mean, I limited myself into dreaming about possible things. Now, about Greece's economic difficulties in the Union, I have to tell you that they don't relate so much to lower productivity. There is a low productivity in the public sector, but there is a very high productivity in the private sector, and Greece has become increasingly competitive in many fields of activity. The problem in Greece is mainly a deficit and debt problem with a result, having as a result high inflation. So if we provide to deal with that, and we can do so in 3 years to come, this means, I think, a period of growth that will contribute greatly into increasing production and productivity. There is another little problem, but I can't start discussing it now, which is a fundamental change in the educational attitudes and practices, especially higher education.
What about Turkey?
What about Turkey? Turkey we have to live with. They will be there. It's God's fate.
Mr. Pangalos.
God put us in this particular part of the world.
Mr. Pangalos, my name is Dimitris Tsoubanos. I am presently a member of the board of directors and past president of the Pan-Patriotic Federation of America, Canada, and Australia. And in that capacity, I would like to ask you to give us an answer as to what is going to happen to the Greeks of Northern Epirus.
Yes, I think I
whose am. Whose lives today, as no, we speak,
listen, Mr. President, I came here for another
are
case.
In danger. But we have to have an answer from you because no, you are
you
the one.
You don't have to get
you
an
are the one that makes
in
the decisions
of this demonstration, which is a speech and a discussion about European perspectives. You are not alone in this room. There are several people
that.
Who came here for what was announced will be the subject of this discussion.
But Albania plays and a role in Europe.
What is the worst part of it? I think you know the answer. So I'm not giving you an answer which you know, because you know the answer, have been given it. Now for 3 days, it has been published in the Greek papers, or the Greek papers in Athens, the Greek papers in America. You know my answer. You simply want to make a rhetoric question. Thank
no,
you very
I do
much
not,
for coming
I wanna,
here.
I do not want to make a rhetoric question. I just want an answer.
Thank you, Minister. I would like to thank again Minister Pangalos, and please ask you to exit through not the forum on the right, but this on the left door through the Belfer side. Thank you very much.